this session particularly to my teacher, Rabbi Soloveitchik, whose 25th anniversary of his death is this year. He died on Chol HaMoed Pesach. So I want to give this session, which is his take on the Haggadah, how he looks at the Haggadah. And I'll give another session after Pesach on his three most important works. That's The Lonely Man of Faith, Halachic Man, and Fate and Destiny, or in Hebrew, Kodo Dido Fake, which is his take of the creation of the human being, the essence of the human being, his understanding of halacha, and the redemptive process. But tonight it's on the Haggadah. He often spoke on the Haggadah. He wrote on the Haggadah. I also wanted to devote this session to a friend, to Evan, in the prayer that he have a refuah shlema, he have a full healing. Evan is struggling with a serious cancer, and I hope he recuperates. Just some background on the Rav was a genius, and he always looked at, I think part of his genius was that he was so multifaceted. And he looks at the Haggadah, and if I spend a little bit of time, as we have, in trying to understand the structure, I glean from his teachings. And we're going to do this a little bit different, because there's so much material I do want to cover. So I'll do this in pieces. There are four pieces to tonight's class, and so it'll be different than the give and take. And I'll talk for about 7 to 10 minutes in each piece, and then we'll stop. So we're going to give Estelle the chance to beat up on what I'm saying, and it would have been nice to see you and the Rav go at it. You would have loved the questions and your comments, everybody's comments. So I'd like to take it from page 10, which is towards the beginning of the Maggid, and we're picking it up now. There's so many different aspects to the Haggadah, but we're particularly picking it up now with the response to the four questions. And this is what he does. We've done this in our Tuesday morning class. For those who have been there, we've spent a lot of time on trying just to understand the structure of the Haggadah, and I presented my own take of it. It's a humble approach, and this is his approach. And what he tries to do is he argues that the first six paragraphs of the Haggadah, and you'll see that he puts together the paragraphs differently than we have it here, the first six paragraphs do not so much deal with the recounting of the story. So we're not going into an in-depth analysis of the story. Rather, they deal with the halachic, the religio-legal imperative to tell the story on Pesach night. So I want to repeat that. He is a halachist, so he wants to understand from where the mitzvah, from where the commandment to tell the story, from where it derives. Now, we're not going to have a structural biblical text here, but this is what these six paragraphs in the Haggadah deal with. So let's take it from, this is my cuz, we call each other cuz, this is Moshe. Let's take it from page 10 and give Moshe a Haggadah. Abadim ayinu l'faro b'mitzrayim. So what he says is that in this paragraph, we hear about the obligation to tell the story. Again, we're not here describing events surrounding the Exodus, rather the halachic framework of the mitzvah to recount the story. And right here it says, we were slaves unto Pharaoh. That's not an in-depth analysis. And the Eternal, our God, brought us forth from there. And then it says, as you continue further, that even if we were wise, if we were people of wisdom, even if we all knew the Torah, three lines from the bottom in the Hebrew, mitzvah aleinu l'sapeh b'tziyat Mitzrayim. There you have it. It is a mitzvah. It is nevertheless incumbent upon us, towards the end, I'm four lines from the bottom in the English, it is incumbent upon us to speak of the departure from Egypt. So there you have the imperative, where the Haggadah is telling us, and the Hebrew is, it's a mitzvah. It's a mitzvah to to tell of this story. This is paragraph one for Rabbi Soloveitchik. Let me go on just for a few more moments, and after this section I'll stop. Paragraph two for the Rav is the next paragraph, which, if you will, is nothing more than a proof text. Here we have a proof text of the greatest of rabbis who are telling the stories. The story, Maaseh v'Rabbi Eliezer, these five rabbis, that they spoke of the departure from Egypt all night. Now you could spend literally hours just on this paragraph. But again, we're trying to understand a skeletal structure of the mitzvah, the imperative. So in paragraph one, it's the mitzvah to tell the story. Paragraph two is an illustration of how even the geniuses of the time were told the story. Now, paragraph three gets a bit more complicated, and this is classic Rabbi Soloveitchik. Paragraph three deals with the imperative to mention the exodus from Egypt on a daily basis, not only in the morning, but at night. Every night when we say the Shema, in the Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu Hashem Echad, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. The third of those paragraphs deals with the exodus from Egypt. What I'm about ready to tell you is classic the Rav. Rabbis are called rabbis. Rabbi Soloveitchik was called the Rav, the rabbi. He could give you a stern look and you could be quaking in your boots, but maybe the next session I'll give you a sense of what it was to sit in his class. Suffice it to say that I always sat in the second row. I sat right behind Bravinda. And if Bravinda sneezed, I sneezed. If he leaned over, I leaned over. And if he decided not to come to class, I didn't come to class. Because in that first year, I just didn't want the Rav to look at me. I once told him I was very frightened of him. And another time, I'll tell you what he said.
Well, he was raised that way, to be scared.
First of all, he apologized to me. He said he didn't mean it. This was later on in his life. And then he said, well, when I study Torah, it's like somebody who has a real understanding of music and sees a symphony orchestra of 200 pieces. And if you really know music, if one of the 200 people in the symphony, instead of playing a B, plays a B flat, everything goes awry. And this was the rub. When someone said something wrong, he didn't mean it, but the whole thing just didn't fit into place. So that's the way he explained it to me. The third paragraph, he says, is, basing himself on the Rambam, on Maimonides, that the commandment to talk about the Exodus from Egypt every night in the evening service is a commandment that stems, it's subsumed under the obligation to describe the Exodus on the night of Passover. And I just said a mouthful. And this is, again, a halachic dance. That is to say that for the Rambam, the obligation to talk about the Exodus from Egypt every night, not only in the morning, but at night in the Shema, that obligation would not have stood on its own, but rather it is under the ambit, it emerges from the obligation to tell the story on the eve of Passover. And you could see his halachic mind working. And then he says that the fourth paragraph tells us that the commandment to tell the story is not only a commandment to tell the story, but to learn the story. And now you're going to see a little bit of his genius. Page 11, the second paragraph. Baruch HaMakom, blessed be the omnipresent, Baruch Hu, may he be blessed. Baruch Shenatan Torah Lamo Yisrael, blessed is the one who gave the Torah to his people Israel. And the Rav, looking at this, says that the language here is very similar to the language of the blessing that we recite when we come to the Torah. When we come to the Torah, we say, Asher Boch Habano Mikol Amim, God, you have chosen us, that requires a lot of explanation, from all the nations, V'natan Lanu et Torato, and you gave us the Torah. That's the language here. Shenatan Torah Lamo Yisrael. He argues that this fourth paragraph is the obligation of in essence, there's no name of God here, but in essence, it's reciting, it's telling us the obligation not only to tell the story, but to learn the story. And it begins with a blessing which mimics, which is very, very similar to the blessing we recite when we come to the Torah. And the fifth paragraph, he bunches together the wise, the wicked, the simple, and the one who doesn't know how to ask a question. He sees that all is one paragraph, and what he says, learning is very much dependent upon the ability of the person, the background of the person, the way a person can comprehend and can understand. He argues, and here I respectfully disagree with him, he argues that if there was a commandment just to tell the story, you can tell one story to every person, and every person could get the story in the same way that the storyteller tells the story. But if it's learning, for example, he gives the example of the Vilna Gaon, one of the greatest geniuses. So the Vilna Gaon, he learned in a way that maybe somebody who doesn't know the Aleph Beis would not know how to learn. He compares it, let's say, to a person who gives charity. Charity is given dependent upon the wherewithal and the ability of the giver. So when it comes to the learning, the fifth paragraph tells us that it should be presented, and he talks about the question and answer format, but it should be presented in a way that each child, and we're all children, can best comprehend the story. So to the sage, to the chacham, it would be presented in his own particular way. To the wicked, whatever Rasha means, in a different way. To the simpleton, in another way. To one who doesn't know how to ask the question, the language is a very, very different language. And that takes us to page 12 at the bottom. And page 12 at the bottom, here, what is laid out is the identification of the date and the time of reciting, of telling the story and of learning the story. One might have thought that maybe I should begin it in the beginning of this month, Yochel Rosh Chodesh. No, the text says Bayomahu, do it on Pesach Day. Maybe it's on the day. No, it's at night. At night, because it's an audiovisual aid. It's at night at the Seder where you have the Pesach, you have the shank bone, you have the matzah, you have the maror. And in the halachic obligation, if there is a halachic obligation, I want to understand what's the timing of the obligation. And that's what this sentence does. So he sees from Avadim Hayinu, which is the top of page 10, until the top of page 13, actually the second paragraph, as laying out the six paragraphs of obligation to tell the story. We've not yet told the story. We've not yet recounted this story, but it's the obligation. I'll just review. In paragraph one, you have that phrase, it is a mitzvah to tell the story. Paragraph two, it's the proof text, even these five rabbis told the story. Part three tells us that based on the obligation of reciting at the night of Passover, we're obligated to do the same every night of the year. Four, we're not only obligated to tell the story, but to learn the story, and that's why that blessing mimics, if you will, it parallels the blessings of the Torah. Paragraph five, the four different presentations, because the learning is an expression, chanoch lanar api darko, educate the child according to his way. And if you have two children, if you have five children, you never educate the child, each child, in the same way. Every child, you have to shape the teaching in the way that a child, in the way that the person can understand. And the sixth step is, okay, we have the halachic obligation, we have the legal obligation. When is that halachic obligation? The obligation is the night of Passover. And with that, he says, the in-depth recounting of the story really begins with Mitchila Ode Avodah Zarah Ayu Avotim. Originally, our ancestors were idolaters, and we'll begin that in a moment. But this ends section one of what I wanted to share with you. In the beginning, we were idol worshippers.
Yeah.
Now, and now,
isn't he talking about Abraham?
And now, God has brought us close to serve him. Now you have a proof text, which is the way of Haggadah. Now we have here quoted a sentence in Joshua. Joshua begins the narration of the history of the Jewish people saying that we begin from the time of Terach. Who was Terach? Terach was Abraham's father. Not only was he Abraham's father, but he also was Sarah's grandfather, because Abraham actually marries his niece, according to most. So Terach, although Terach gets a bad rap, Terach is actually a very important person. It's not so bad if you're the father of Abraham and your grandfather of Sarah. How bad could you be? As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us that before God commands Abraham to go to Canaan, which is Israel, Terach on his own is attracted to Canaan, and he begins the trek. That's what the Torah tells us at the end of the portion of Noah. If we were studying this sentence by sentence, we'd actually open the text and take a look at it, but that's what the text tells us. So the story of the Exodus doesn't begin from the moment we were in Egypt and then released, but it starts from we were idol worshippers. Now here, I want to interject my own thinking. And this is something that we spoke about on Tuesday morning. The truth is that in the Talmud, I don't mean to confuse you, there are two opinions of how to tell the story of the Exodus from Egypt. There's a difference of opinion between Shmuel and Rav. One is we were slaves and we were released. That's the top of page 10. The second is we were idol worshippers and now we've come close to Sinai to serve God. All I want to leave with you is the following. That while Passover night stresses the exodus from Egypt. That's what it stresses. There's very little that is said about the splitting of the sea. Very little that is said, very few times that we're standing at Sinai. It's touched on very little. Very little that is said about our entry into the land of Israel. It's the celebration of the exodus. I think this paragraph is saying, well, had we not come out of Egypt, nothing would have happened. But coming out of Egypt is not enough. In contemporary times, we've experienced many revolutions. The Arab Spring, for example. The Arab Spring were moments in the Middle East when Arab countries were apparently revolting against dictatorships, and there was such a great hope of a new democracy in the Middle East. Yeah, but that's not what happened. In many countries, it's worse than ever. Anybody who thinks that in Egypt this week they're having elections, that it's a democratic election, I mean, it's nonsense. That's not what's happening in Saudi Arabia. Well, Saudi Arabia didn't have one of those revolutions, but in Libya, it goes on and on and on. And I believe that in telling the story here, I did not hear this from the Rav, but I just want to interject this, that we're being told that this is a celebration of the Exodus from Egypt, but the Exodus from Egypt is not only a celebration of freedom from, it is a celebration of freedom to. If it is a celebration of freedom from, I call that reactive Judaism. I am reacting against a tyranny, I'm standing up and I'm rebelling against that tyranny. And for me, as important as that is, for me that falls into the category of reactive Judaism. It's negative Judaism. It's very important Judaism. Not everything that's negative is bad. You're fighting against something that is horrific. And there are many Jews today, I'm not taking a survey, but a large number of Jews today who are against Nick Jews. They identify themselves by what they're fighting against. Why am I a Jew? I am a Jew because I'm a Jew, I identify myself as a Jew, ADL style, and they do very important work, because when I see a swastika, I take great exception, and I'm going to stand up and I'm going to fight against that swastika. But what I've learned is that reactive Judaism, negative Judaism, and we have to take second place to no one when it comes to standing up for who we are. But if we are only a reactive people, reactive Judaism will not endure. We only endure if we can turn that which is reactive into something which is proactive. And that's what's being said here. yes, this is a celebration of the Exodus, but it's much deeper. It was the Exodus for a purpose. We were idol worshippers, and now we have come close to God to serve God. It's a Torah. That's the Jew who says, you know why I'm a Jew? I'm a Jew not just for negative reasons, but for positive reasons. I'm a Jew because Shabbat means something to me. However you celebrate Shabbat, I'm a Jew because I read a Jewish book. I listen to JBS. I go to a class. I identify in some positive way to the nationhood. I mean, as a rabbi, from a religious perspective, spiritual perspective, whatever it is, I proactively identify with Judaism. And it's proactive Judaism that will endure. If I am a Jew only to go to protest, I'm not going to make it. In all my protest days, those barricades for me, in the end, they were a point of entry for many Jews, opening the door to thinking about proactive Judaism. That's really, in the end, what it's about. Even when it comes to Israel. Israel today, in many ways, the Chok HaShvut, the law of return, one of the first laws introduced in Israel was that any Jew can become a citizen of it immediately. I'm going to Israel in a few weeks. My dream was always to be a member of the Knesset. That will not happen in my lifetime. At least I want to become a citizen, and I'm out to become a citizen of Israel. Now, I could become a citizen right away. I'm a Jew. Why? Isn't that racist? Why is it that a Jew can become a citizen right away and nobody else can? Why is that? Well, it's a profoundly religious concept. Because from 1933 to 1941, Hitler, Yimach Shemo, did not want to kill Jews. That was not his plan. His plan was to get rid of Jews. But guess what? Except for some small countries in the Caribbean, we had nowhere to go. America closed its door. David Wyman just died. Bless his memory. He wrote Abandonment, the American Abandonment of the Jews. Serious business. My bubby used to call Roosevelt Rosenberg. He was no Rosenberg. We didn't hit the quotas, let alone the quotas were never expanded. So Israel says that'll never happen again. And we're going to have a Jewish army. And we're not going to depend on anyone to defend ourselves except the Jewish army. And you've heard me say many times, for me, the holiest Jew is a member of the Israeli army. I've been criticized for saying that. I'll say it over and over and over again. And that is very important. It is very important for Israel to be a place that is against any threat, stands against any threat. Israel just said that it took out the Syrian nuclear reactor. Believe me, that's what it did. And if it's going to have to take out the Iranian nuclear reactor on its own, it'll find a way. But if that's all that Israel is about, Israel's in trouble. Israel is in trouble. That's why when you go into the army in Israel, there are classes now that are being given making sure that soldiers understand what proactively they're fighting about. What is Israel all about? So when we recount the story, and it's an in-depth recounting of the story, we're going to tell the story of Mitchila Obe Avodah Zarah Hayo Avotenu, that we were first idol worshippers, but Bachshav Kirvanu Hamakom Lavadoto. Now God has drawn us closer to His service. So that was my personal comment, and I want to share with you something that Rabbi Soloveitchik says on this paragraph. He notes that God is here referred to by a very strange appellative title. Hi, David. He's referred to here as Hamakom. It says, originally our ancestors were idolaters, but at present the Lord has brought us near to His service. So you would think the Lord, there are many appellative titles for the Lord. What are some names for God? Hashem, Elohim, whatever you want. How is God referred to here? He's referred to as Hamakom. Now here's the genius of Rabbi Soloveitchik. We just finished analyzing his halachic mind, how he sees the Serk's paragraph as the halachic imperative to tell the story. Now, once we're telling the story, He's focusing in on words, and he says the following. Hamakom, this is a beautiful concept. Wherever you are, Rebbe. One of many beautiful trillion concepts that he's shared over the years. Maybe not a trillion, but a lot. Hamakom literally means the place, the omnipresence. That's the name of God. What does omnipresence mean? God is all over. God is all over. God is all over. Even in places you don't expect God to be. Even in places where people say, I reject you, God. Even when people are uncertain of God, or maybe where people are denying God. And so, in a house of Shiva, where maybe the bereaved are struggling with faith. Look, different people sit Shiva in different ways. For some people, it's a reinforcing of faith. It could happen. But when we sat Shiva for our infant son, I was struggling with God. I was very uncertain. It was faith, it was uncertainty of faith, uncertainty of belief. And even in the house of Shiva, where everyone has a right to be perhaps upset with God, we say, Hamakom, Yenachem Elchem. Even there, God is present. Omnipresent. It's simple to be present when things are going well. That's easy. Are you there? Or can we express a belief God is there even when there's darkness? Or in the prayer, when we pray for those of our people in the world who are struggling, we say, Achenu Beit Yisrael, Anatumim Batzara Ubishivya, our brothers and sisters who are in distress, we say, may the Lord have mercy on you. And what's the Hebrew for the Lord there? Hamakom Yirachem Aleha. Again, it's Hamakom. Yom Kippur Davening. We, right in the beginning, we say, B'yeshiva Shalmala U'B'yeshiva Shalmata, Aldat Hamakom. Right in the beginning, we say, we're praying with all the sinners, and even there, Hamakom Yirachem Aleha. And so he says, that as we tell the story of the Exodus from Egypt, we're in Egypt, in that servitude, in that hell. Even there, Vachshav Kirbanu Hamakom Lavavato, somehow, even there, the omnipresence from Egypt will take us place, will take us close to serving Him. I'll tell you something very radical. You know the Elie Wiesel story at the end of chapter 4 of Night, where he's witnessing a little boy being hanged. Remember that story? And the child, he's in Auschwitz, the child is so light that he's dangling. He doesn't die right away. Generally, the heaviness on the rope kills the person. He's so light, he's dangling between life and death. And Wiesel records the story, Elie Sheldon records the story that the person behind him said, the person behind him asked, where is God, looking at this child struggling? And Wiesel said, I think that's the way the story goes, that Wiesel responded, there he is. He's hanging from the noose now. What does that mean now? The simple meaning is it means what it means. But if you want to read into that story of Hamakom, that's the challenge. Can you find God even in that kind of place? Can you find God even in Egypt? And then the paragraph continues again in the second section. I just want to speak for another few minutes and then take your thoughts. In the next paragraph, Baruch Shomeh Tachlato L'Yisrael, blessed be he who observes strictly his promise unto Israel. Blessed is be the Holy One who computed the end of the captivity, and so on and so forth. Here what it says is that God was very, very much involved in taking us out of Egypt. And God took us out of Egypt as part of God's covenantal promise to Abraham. Let's take a look at that paragraph. Blessed be he who observes strictly his promise unto Israel. Blessed be the Most Holy One who computed the end of captivity. that he might perform what he promised to our father Abraham, that you will be strangers 400 years. In the end, it was 210 years. And I will take you out. This is the first time that the word brit to the Jewish people, actually to the Jewish family, is found in the whole Torah. Vayom ahu karat Hashem brit et Avraham. God cuts the covenant with Abraham. This is the covenant of the pieces. And what does God say to Abraham? God says to Abraham, I covenantly promise you, and it's a unilateral promise, it is unconditional until eternity, till the end of time and beyond the end of time, there will always be a Jewish people. No matter the darkness that you face, like the darkness of Egypt, I'm promising you, unilaterally, you will survive. You will make it out. I'll say this tangentially, by the way, the same is not true about sovereignty over the land of Israel. Is it a unilateral covenantal promise that they will always, we will always be sovereign in the land of Israel? What's the answer to that question? Of course not. We weren't sovereign for 2,000 years. That's a bilateral promise. That depends upon us. But the promise of the eternality of the Jewish people, no matter how dark it gets, from darkness will come light, from twilight there will be dawn. That is God's covenantal promise. And then, the next paragraph, the He She'amda Lavotein. And it is this promise. Now, there are all kinds of exegesis on the He. The Vav is six sets of Mishnayot, the five books of Torah, the Ten Commandments, the Aleph, the belief in God. No. Ein Mikra Yotzei Midei Truto. The He means, and it's that covenant. This is one of the most important paragraphs. She'amda Lavoteinu V'lanu. That is what sustained not only the history of our people, but all of us. And this paragraph is the essence of Haggadah. Shelo echad bilvad amad aleinu lechaloteinu. We've not just gone through one Egypt. Elo shebechol dor vador omdim aleinu lechaloteinu. In every generation, there are those who have risen to destroy us. But God has saved us. This paragraph is a very critical paragraph because it says two things. A, it says the story of the Exodus of Egypt from darkness to light is a story that is constantly repeated. Mitzrayim comes from the word tsarot. We've had a lot of tsarot through our histories. Min hametzah karatika. From the distress. That's what Mitzrayim really means. It's a story repeated over. Destruction of the first temple, Babylonia, Rome, Persia, Rome, Spanish Inquisition, Moniki, the Russian pogroms in the beginning of the 20th century, Germany in the 1930s and 1940s, Soviet Russia. It's repeated over and over. That's why the clarion call of the Soviet Jewry movement, even for Jews who were not spiritually religious, even they were calling out biblical concepts. Let my people go. We don't realize that that was one of the greatest achievements of American Jewry, the freedom of millions of Jews from behind the Iron Curtain. And B, that it's been repeated and we've been freed against all logic. As Toynbee once said, if logic would dictate that, and he was no lover of the Jewish people should be fossils today. What has sustained us? Yes, it's been our effort, but ultimately, it's that unconditional covenantal promise, unilateral promise from God. This paragraph is a key paragraph. I'll speak for just a few more moments and to say the following, that it's this point that we continue the elaboration of the recounting. Here we've recounted the story in some depth, but here we recount it by actually learning. And this again is the Rav's mind. And we've studied this. Sei Ulamad is really an encapsulation. It is a study of four sentences from the Torah, which appear in the book of Deuteronomy, when the farmer brought the first fruits, the Bikurim, the Arami Oved Avi. And each of these sentences are explicated in a midrash. Now, I've spoken to my son about this, who is a scholar in Midrash, and God willing, we're going to learn together this Midrash. is this a midrash? Where does it come from? Was it compiled for the Haggadah? It's very, very complicated. You can look at each sentence and you can spend hours on each sentence. Why these four sentences were chosen from Deuteronomy, why not from the book of Exodus? We've studied that actually on Tuesday morning. But here what we're doing is we are explicating sentences from the Torah Shebichtav, and that continues, believe it or not. The explication ends with the Dayenu, and Dayenu is sort of like a euphoric singing out of, oh God, we're so grateful for all that you did for us. And then if you turn to page 22, Rabban Gamliel Haya Omer, this is a Mishnaic study, a Tanaitic study. Now we're getting into the oral tradition. Follow? So first, let me review this. We're recounting the story by telling the story in depth. That's different than the first section I spoke about because that was the mitzvah to recount, mitzvah lein lizaper. Then we actually did the recounting from mitzilah. And then it's not only recounting the story, but learning the story in depth. And we learnt the written text, and now we're beginning to learn Mishnayot. This is from the tractate Psachim, Pesach Matzah Umaror. And the last part, the Rav says in sentence 23, that really is the kind of learning that you find in the Gemara. The Gemara is based on Svara. Svara is logic. Lefikach, and therefore, we're no longer now in the Mishnaic text. Lefikach anachnu chayavim lahodot lahalel lishabech. Therefore, because of this great exodus, it's logical that we should be offering praise and thanksgiving and declaring hallelujah to God. And that's why it continues here with the first two paragraphs of the Hallelujah, the Hallel. And with this, we end the second section of what of the four sections that I wanted to share with you this evening. Again, here we actually are recounting the story. And there's also a piece here, not recounting by telling the story, the history in depth, but we're learning the story. And we're learning the story by touching Torah Shebichtav, the written law, and then the Mishnaic law, and then the oral tradition. I'll stop here to take your questions, reflections, thoughts. Yes?
I don't
We've covered a lot of ground. So.
No, it isn't that. You're saying that they took portions from Deuteronomy and from Exodus and stuff, but when did this start? When did they start telling the story, and who were the people who took the different sections?
Right. Well, as I've been saying, the taking of the sections, when you look at the Haggadah, if I ever do write a commentary, I hope I find the strength and the time. God gives me the years. What I would do is I would try to paint the Haggadah based on the skeletal part, almost in history. There, it's like the organs of the body, the heart, the liver, the kidneys, and then you have the capillaries, the arteries. There are central pieces of the Haggadah, which really comes from early. You can find it in the oral. It goes all the way back to the Talmud. And then later on, these were taken and you have additions. There are many, many very late additions. The whole end of the Seder, it's very contemporary. And there's stuff, by the way, that is still added to the Seder.
Who wrote it? That's what I'm asking.
But it's not clear. There are different Haggadot. If you look into Maimonides actually has a text of the Haggadah, which is pretty much like this one, but there are many different variations. There are different Haggadot, and it got added, and it's no longer the $64,000 question, but there's no simple answer to that, except that it's a compilation over years, and there are pieces that come from very early, and others that are, like the Dayenu is very late, that's for sure. The Dayenu is, somebody read through those four sentences and was taken by it and said, Dayenu, and the Dayenu is a text that, again, you know, we have here. Yes, please, go ahead.
Is the Sephardic Haggadah different from
yes.
this one?
Yeah. Yeah. It's similar, but it's different in many ways.
All the Haggadot are the same?
The Ashkenazi?
Worldwide?
No, they're very different Haggadot. There are Temani Haggadot. But the central pieces that come from the Mishnah that we just read now, those four sentences, which is really the central piece from Arami Ovid Avi, and the Mishnayot of Rabban Gamliel, they're all the same. Nobody's going to tamper with that, but you're going to have embellishments, you're going to have additions.
Throughout the world?
Yes, David, yeah.
I didn't want to say anything.
Let me go to the third section. The third piece that he introduced, and I don't want to hold you too long, so we got a third and a fourth piece. The third piece is, and Jews love this, are you ready? That in the Haggadah, within the legal aspects of the Haggadah, is the telling of the story. Not only by telling the story, not only by learning the story, are you ready? But through food. The consumption of food on every level in the Haggadah is part of the narrative. From the beginning, for example, what's the first thing we eat or drink at the Seder?
Wine.
Wine. We say the Kiddush. Now, generally speaking, on a Yom Tov, on a Shabbat, when do we say Kiddush? Can we begin Kiddush before nightfall? Of course we can. You add to Shabbat, so, you know, at sunset, by sunset you can already say Kiddush. Many of the holidays we begin at sunset a little bit before. But the Kiddush on Passover at the Seder, it can only be said after the stars come out, after nightfall. Why is that? Well, because when we're drinking the Kiddush, the actual drinking the Kiddush, in the drinking we are imbibing, we are, through taking in the wine, we are living the joy of the Exodus. And the Exodus must be only once it's nightfall. And in fact, in the Kiddush, the text of the Kiddush, the Rav also points out, Asher Bachavanu, you chose us. Well, when we actually became a people is complex, but if you argue that it's from the Exodus, well, it has to be at night. And that's an example of the Kiddush. Or when we get to the Haggadah, when we get to that Mishnah that we went through, this Haggadah of Rabban Gamliel says that on Passover Eve, we always have to point to the Pesach, Matzah, and Morah. The Pesach on our plate, what is the Pesach? That's the shank bone. The Matzah is the Matzah. The Morah is the Morah. So, and you're supposed to point to it. Pesach, Matzah. The joke in our family, every time we get to Morah, which means the bitter herbs, is Toby points at me. All kinds of jokes that go on at every Seder table. But we point to it, and that the Rav understands as the introduction to what we will ultimately do. And what will we ultimately do after we wash our hands? We will eat the matzah. We will eat the Morah. It's fascinating. And frankly, if there were a temple, we would have been eating the Paschal lamb. But we don't touch the shank bone because there is no temple. But we're eating. Eating is an expression of a recognition of, in the matzah, well, that's a poor person's bread, and we ate it as we left. Morar certainly is the bitter herbs. Let me add this. I didn't hear this from the Rav, but I want to go so far as to say that the very meal, the knedlach, and the chicken, whatever everybody is waiting for, that too is not separate from the Passover experience. That part, and it's not just a Passover experience of eating, it's a Passover religious experience. If I were teaching the Haggadah, to me the key to the Haggadah is to recognize that the meal splits the Haggadah into two, what precedes the meal and what follows the meal. What precedes the meal is the recounting of the past story. What follows the meal is the hope for the future redemption. I want to repeat that. That is the key. What precedes the meal is past. What follows the meal is the hope of redemption. That's why right before we begin the telling of the story in the beginning, we take the matzah and what do? We break it in half, yachatz. Now the matzah is the one symbol at the Seder which represents both the slavery and the matzah was the poor person's bread in Egypt, and was also, we ran out so the dough didn't rise and we ate the matzah. And we take half of it, and one half is left on the Seder table and the other half is going to be the last food we consume before we start telling the future story. And my argument is that the first half is on the table because it represents the telling of the past story. The other half remains to the end because that jettisons us, catapults us into the telling and the hope of the future story. And for those who forget, well, no one can crack a matzah perfectly in half. So is it the smaller one that stays on the table or the larger one? Always remember, it's the smaller one that stays on the table and the bigger one that remains for the end. You know why? Because the redemption from Egypt was sweet, but there's going to be a bigger redemption. And that redemption is going to be the future redemption. In fact, there are commentaries who argue that in the time of redemption, we're not going to even recall the Exodus from Egypt. And if it will be recalled, it'll be a very big subtext. It will not be a major text. But I want to argue as follows. I want to argue that what precedes the meal is the past. Notice I'm pushing it. What follows the meal is the hope for the future. And what about the meal? I want to argue that's the present. That's the present. That's the present moment of trying to integrate within our system through the eating the joy that we're experiencing in the joy that we're experiencing in contemporary life. By the way, that's the reason why we bench. And I once gave a shiur showing that the Birkat HaMazon, the grace after meal, is actually the Haggadah. The grace after meal is the first paragraph, we thank God for food. But the second paragraph, what do we say? Nodelecha, for those who know it, Hashem Elokeinu. What do we say? You know, you can see it here. If you take a look at it, I just don't want you to, page 30, this is now the Birkat HaMazon. We give thanks unto thee, O eternal our God, for having caused our ancestors to inherit that desirable good and ample land, and because you brought us out from the land of Egypt. We tell the story again in Birkat HaMazon. You brought us out from Egypt, brought us to Israel, and the next paragraph is going to be brought us to Jerusalem, and then the next part of the Birkat HaMazon is really dealing with the destruction of the temple and the hope for the rebuilding of the temple. The Birkat HaMazon is a microcosm of the whole Haggadah. The meal is the present expression of the story of Yitzhak Mitzrayim. Before the meal is the past, following the meal is the future, and the meal is the present. And with this, I want to just add one last point, section 4, but I want to stop here and ask if anybody has any thoughts, b'vakasha. By the way, note, this is the only time when the halal is broken. It's fascinating, the halal is broken, and actually the Mishnah talks about is machloket between Bet Shammai and Bet Hillel as to how much of the first two paragraphs, you just say the first paragraph or both paragraphs, but we follow Bet Hillel. We say the two paragraphs before the meal. And in those two paragraphs, it says, "B'tzeit Yisrael mi'Mitzrayim," you took us out of Egypt. That's the past. The last part of the halal, which deals with the hope of future redemption, "Yivarechet Beit Yisrael," that's the future. That's why at the end of my father's and mother's Seder, you know what they used to do? They used to stand up and sing HaTikvah. These great Zionists from before there was the State of Israel, that's what they used to do. And that segues into the last comment that I wanted to make about Rabbi Soloveitchik, and that is the following. If you go back to the Tsei Ulamad, which is on page 14, those are the four sentences. There's actually a fifth sentence in that text. Anybody know what that fifth sentence is? The first sentence is that we went down to Egypt and we flourished. Second sentence is basically we were enslaved. The third sentence is we called out to God. The fourth sentence is Vayotzienu, God took us out. And there's a fifth sentence. And what is that fifth sentence? The fifth sentence is Vayivienu el hamakom hazeh, God brought us into Israel. And we don't explicate that sentence. In passing, that's why some people have a fifth cup of wine. Some people say that's the cup of Elijah too. But we do not explicate that fifth sentence. So I want to read with you a piece of Rabbi Soloveitchik. This is now his writing, which is, you take one, pass it down, and with this we'll call my He is here trying to explain why that fifth sentence. We have four sentences that we study. Why don't we study that fifth sentence? And here's what he says. Let's take a look at it inside. Yeah. Although the Jewish people, let's pass it down. We have plenty. It pays to take this home. Alan, do you have?
Yes.
Okay. Alan, do you mind reading? Although
the Jewish people did enter into the land of Israel subsequent to the exodus from Egypt, this was not the primary goal of Yetziat Mitzrayim. It was their destination.
It was their destination, but not their destiny. That is classic Soloveitchik. What does he mean by this? Although the Jewish people did enter the land of Israel subsequent to the exodus from Egypt, this was not the primary goal of Yetziat Mitzrayim. This was not the primary goal of the exodus. You should memorize that. It was their destination, but not their destiny. Let's take it a little further, Alan.
The direct goal of Yetziat Mitzrayim was the revelation at Sinai.
Ah. Even though that's not the focus at the Seder. Although at the Seder, when we start recounting the story, it says we were idol worshippers, and now, God, you took us to your service, which is Sinai. Continue just a little further. The goal?
The goal was the transformation of a subjugated people into a nation of priests and a holy nation. It was not just to grant them political and economic freedom, but also to create a sacred
now,
people.
Let's stop for a second. This is Rav Soloveitchik.
They're hardly a sacred people.
Well, what is he arguing here? He seems to be arguing that we could very well be a sacred people. Finish my sentence.
Without Israel. What is sacred?
It's our destination, but it's not built into our destiny. Ellen, do you want to take it further? Now he's going to expand. I could put this in a separate paragraph. Moshe, go on.
Moshe.
This is a new paragraph. Now he's amplifying.
Moshe, at the episode of the burning bush, asked the Almighty, "Who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh and that I should bring forth?"
Speak up loud so we can pick you up on the little video. Hey, Barry. Is Ellen on the video, Barry? Okay, go ahead. Who am I?
Okay. Who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh and that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt?
That's from Exodus 3. Go on. And the Almighty.
And the Almighty gives us an answer that seems at first to be a bit difficult. Certainly I will be with you, and this shall be unto you the sign that I have sent you. When thou hast brought forth the people out of Egypt, they shall serve God upon his mount.
It means Sinai. Go on.
What was the Almighty saying to Moshe? How did this answer his query? The Almighty was stating, "No, Moshe, that the people of..."
No, Moshe, that the purpose of the redemption of the Exodus, of the redemption from Egypt, is not political or social freedom. This is heavy stuff. What is it? For that task, Estelle, do you want to take it? For that task,
I would not have picked.
Isn't
you.
That something? You're no political leader, Moses. That's not your strength. That's not what you're about. Go on.
I did not pick you to be a diplomat or a king.
You're not a Menachem Begin. You're not a Ben Gurion. I did not pick you to be a diplomat or a king or political leader. Go on. Rather,
the purpose of the Exodus is to create a holy nation, to make them a Torah nation. For this purpose, God says, I need a Rebbe.
What is Moshe called? Not Moshe HaMelech, he's called Moshe Rabbeinu. He's the Rebbe. God, a teacher, go on, and mentor.
A teacher and mentor who will lead and guide this people. And for this role, you are the best candidate.
Now, he goes on to say that Shavuot is, of course, a celebration of revelation. And Sukkot, he quotes the view of Maimonides in the guide, Gemara Nebuchadnezzar, who says Sukkot is the celebration of Israel. A lot can be said about that. But what he's saying is, right at the top, this way I'm reading it, and I'd love to get your pushback, he's saying that entry into the land was not the primary goal of the Exodus from Egypt. Now I'm going to be giving some other classes on the Rav in honor of the 25th
what
anniversary
of his
death.
What does he mean by sacred? After all, the Jews aren't really sacred. What does sacred mean? Sacred means holy and purposeful and everything,
that's what it means.
We haven't seen it through the generations, have we?
Well, I ask you.
But wasn't the intent of Moses when he led the people out of Egypt to go to Israel, to go back?
To worship him, he took them out so that
so
they could worship him.
So that was this place of sins in their destination.
There's no doubt ultimately.
But isn't destination and destiny linked?
Well, you tell me.
Well, if you take destination literally, it's a place.
Place.
A destiny.
Destiny means
it's how you'll be
built
remembered.
Into your essence.
This is that the essence of their goal to go.
He was
turn.
A great. Well, first, on one dimensional level, he is arguing that that fifth sentence of Vayivyenu is not in the Haggadah because it's not central to the story of the Exodus. That is what he is arguing. That's what he's arguing. It was the ultimate destination, but he writes, this was not the primary goal of Yitzhak Mitzrayim, and since it was not the primary goal, we're not going to be explaining that sentence. We're just not going to go there. Now, that's what he argues. Now, you know, I would push back on him. And there was a time I would never push back on him, but listen, I hit 70 already, now I can push back, and he would want me to push back, because I'm not at all convinced that I think Israel is peppered throughout the Seder. There's a lot of Israel all over the Seder, but I just want to put this out there for you. I'm going to be giving more sessions on the Rav. I feel that obligation after Passover, after Pesach, and I'm thinking of giving one talking about Rabbi Soloveitchik's approach to this, to the religious meaning of the State of Israel in contrast to Rav Kook, the first chief rabbi of Israel before there was formally a state. This is something I believe Rav Kook could never, ever say. I don't think Rav Kook could say that the purpose of the Exodus, as he says over here, that a primary goal of the Exodus, he writes here, the Exodus from Egypt, the land of Israel was not a primary goal of the Exodus. I don't think Rav Kook could say that. I think for Rav Kook, built into the sacredness of our peoplehood, it's inextricably bound to the land of Israel. And their lives bear witness to these two different positions. Rabbi Soloveitchik visited Israel, I believe, in the 30s. I don't believe he ever went back to Israel, even for a visit. Think about that. I don't believe he ever went there. You probably know better than I do.
No, he didn't.
I don't think he did. He was invited to be the second chief rabbi, and he famously said, I don't want to preside over the demise of the chief rabbinate, because he had great problems with the chief rabbinate, because it's a coercive centralized body. And he understood that spirituality and religious striving does not come through coercion, not through kfiyat hadat. But think about it. The state is established in 1948. 1967, Yerushalayim, the Six-Day War. 1967, he was a very young man. He was born in 1903. He was 64. He died when he was 90 years old in 1993. 67, I was in his class then. He was a tyrant. Strong. Very strong. And in the 70s, I think he became softer after his wife died, frankly, because he was a man of such intellectual genius, and he saw genius doctors who couldn't save his wife. I think that softened him. I do believe he became a different person after that. But he never went back. Hold on just a second, son. He never went back. And I think that speaks volumes to his relationship to Israel. Whereas Rav Kook, I don't know if you know this, but Rav Kook during World War I, he had left Israel, and he went to England, and then he got caught in England and in America, and he never made it back until after World War I. But he got back. And for him, the land of Israel is inextricably bound to the destiny of Israel. He could never, in my opinion, I could be wrong, but in my opinion, he could never write the second sentence, it was, that is, Israel was their destination, but not their destiny. I don't think he could.
Is it possible that Rabbi Soloveitchik could have taken some of his thoughts from Schneerson, who felt that he could never go to Israel because then if he left, he would be going Yored as opposed to being up there. So I was just wondering if he might have felt the same way.
I think that the Rav and the Lubavitcher Rebbe, they had areas of overlap, and you're discussing one. The Rebbe was not in Israel. I don't think he ever went to Israel.
No, he said he wouldn't.
But I would say the following. The Rav will stand for HaTikva. The Rebbe, maybe out of respect, but let me put it this way. The Rav would recite a prayer for the establishment of the State of Israel, and he would say, Reshit Smichat Latin, it is the beginning of the dawn of our redemption. He saw profound religious meaning in the establishment of the state. I don't think the Lubavitcher Rebbe would say that prayer.
But then why would he have gone? I mean,
say is that even when from your perspective, Estelle, you're right that maybe the Rebbe and the Rav didn't go because he was, you can go there for a week and it's not as if you're forgetting your flock. There's a difference between, I'm arguing, Rabbi Cook and Rabbi Soloveitchik, and while there are similarities between Rabbi Soloveitchik and Lubavitcher Rebbe, there are differences. And that is Rabbi Soloveitchik saw profound religious meaning. He classically gave, there's a book, Chamesh Roshot, that he gave to the religious Zionist. He did see religious meaning. He saw the hand of God as a dawn of redemption in the establishment of the state. I don't think the Rebbe would say that. The Rebbe loved Israel. The Rebbe loved Jews. And today the majority of Jews in the world are living in Israel. For that reason alone, he cared deeply about Israel. But if you would ask him, does the government of Israel have religious meaning? I think deep down the Rebbe would say, like any government, it rules, but I don't think he would say that it had religious meaning. Would Rabbi Soloveitchik say it had religious meaning? I'm convinced that he would. He would say that it's the dawn of redemption, and whoever is running the government of Israel, it's almost parallel to it's an embodiment, if you will, of leadership that's found in the Torah. Rav Cook writes that the Knesset, he writes, the Prime Minister, he writes, is the embodiment of Malchut Yisrael. It is the contemporary kingship. That's what
is that the symbol of sacredism?
Sacredness means that we live a holy life.
Oh, yeah.
Sacredness means, separate from the ritual of Shabbat and all of that, separate from that, it means Vasita Hayashav V'Atov B'nei Hashem. It means walking with God. It means walking humbly with God. Have there been moments of sacredness of the Jewish people? Of course. Nothing's perfect. We're not perfect. We've had better times. We've had less than perfect times. And most of the times, there are those who've been up and those who've been down. And as Kohelet says, there's no righteous person. I'm talking to myself and letting you listen. There's no person who's done good who's not done bad. We all have had our moments, but the goal is to do whatever we can to lead a better, more perfected life. That's what sacredness. Sacredness means, in a religious sense, it's walking with God, and all of that flows from that. Questions, thoughts.
I was just wondering if Soloveitchik traveled to other places. Maybe he's just not a traveler.
That's a great question. I don't.
I mean, he did what?
I don't know.
Man, you know.
I know that he shuttled from Boston to.
Right.
That's very thought.
That's
a good
point.
I'll tell you a story, and with this we'll end, about Soloveitchik.
Yeah, isn't the soul of the Jewish people tied up with the concept of Israel?
I would say yes.
Throughout
that
time.
This is what
that's
these...
That's only since Herzl.
Right.
No, I would think that it was always the abiding motivation. We always said, next year in Jerusalem, people throughout the ages and time have yearned for Israel even before it was a state.
Well, we'll try to expand on that if I get to this session. But you know, for me now, I'm talking personally. The national destiny, using that word, for me, the national destiny of the Jewish people. That is the destiny, our imperative to our share to be a light to the nations of the world. For me, it only plays out in the land of Israel. I'm not saying that there are no communities in America that are great communities. We do some nice things. The RJC does some nice things. The Minyan does some nice things. We do. But in America, this is not a Jewish country. We're not sovereign here. We don't have autonomy here. Often, as powerful as Jews think that we are, we're often reacting and not acting, and it remains to be seen how this is going to be played out 10, 20, long after I'm gone, 50 years from now. Who knows what it's going to be? There's only one place where we can act and not react, where we are sovereign, where we have autonomy, where we potentially, we're not yet there, potentially can be the light to the nations of the world. And I believe that that place is Eretz Yisrael. That's the meaning of Zionism. What's the Hebrew word for Zionist?
Tzion.
What does that word come from?
Mitzuyan.
Mitzuyan, which means?
Perfection.
Excellence. Tzion is like the target. You can only hit the target there. Now, what I'm sharing with you is a subject of a lot of controversy. A lot of people push back and say, you know, for example, Judah Magnus, who was a reform rabbi, he became the president of Hebrew University, I think the first president. He famously said there can't be a Jewish state, even though he was living in Jerusalem. It should be a binational state and no army, and we share Jerusalem. And as a matter of fact, Jews, we have to understand, to be a light to the nations of the world, we should have communities all over the world, because if we're in one place, what kind of light to the nations of the world can you be? But Rav Kook says, no, we can be in one place, and we could be the laboratory to show how a government can operate. And I must say that with all the challenges that Israel faces, and just bridging from Rabbi Soloveitchik to the 70th anniversary, I'm very proud of Israel. Israel has done great, great, great things. And not only because of the startups and entrepreneurial stuff, but the medicine and the advances that have been made, and the Torah for those. There's more Torah being studied in Israel today than I think at any time in any place in all of Jewish history. There are great things happening. So, but I think the Rav had a, I think that the Rav was, he loved Israel. I don't think he ever encouraged his students to go on Aliyah, but when they went, I think he was very, very happy that they went on Aliyah. He loved Israel, he wrote about Israel, but I don't think he saw built into Torah the destiny being the land of Israel. And for him, that's why there's no explication of the fifth sentence. But as I said, for Rav Kook, that's not his language. For Rav Kook, Israel is not only the destination, but it is the destiny.
It is.
Thanks for coming out.
Thank you, Rabbi.
Thank you, Moshe. Thank you. So, thank you.
Rabbi.